Hello aspirants, looking at editorials and question bank for 29th November. The first editorial in the Hindu newspaper today is Lessons from Another Jailbreak. So this is regarding the jailbreak which earlier took place, that was SIMI, Students Islamic Movement of India. SIMI members who were under trial and behind bars had escaped from the prison in Bhopal. So they were chased and eventually killed in an encounter, all of them. Plus presently the news comes of another jailbreak in Punjab in which six prisoners escaped and one of them was also Khalistan Liberation Front leader Harminder Mintu. This we have just discussed in news. So this escape also highlights now about the security conditions in our jails. Security is not foolproof. Also, he has been arrested. Even the mastermind behind this jailbreak has been arrested from Shamli district in UP, in Kairana. So this we have already discussed. But what is highlighted in this editorial is that it requires a thorough investigation about how escapes from prisons can take place. So this shows that a conspiracy is hatched. They keep in touch with accomplices outside. They finalize their escape plans with all details. So how is this possible? The thorough investigation is required in such matters, in which such that prisoners escape from jails. Also, the other part talks of politicization of the whole issue, because Punjab is going for assembly elections in 2017, start of 2017. So that is the reason why this whole issue has been politicized as well, that even before the jailbreak has been thoroughly investigated, and even while the hunt is going for the escaped men, people are throwing in their political perspectives and giving it a political overtone. So that is another aspect to the whole matter. Then the next editorial is two-pronged war in Iraq. So this is regarding the blast in Hilla, which is a region between two important towns located in Iraq, which are important for Shias. This is Najaf and Karbala. So these are Shia Islam's holiest places, two amongst the holiest places, where Shia Muslims travel on pilgrimage every year around this time. So a blast taking place, killing 100 people here, and mostly the people killed are Iranian pilgrims. So this has been done, undertaken by IS. So this is how IS functions too, because it is facing pressure in Mosul. So Mosul lies north up here. You can see Najaf and Karbala here. Hilla is somewhere in between these two pilgrim sites. And an attack on civilians here is what it's trying to do, is diverting attention from the war which has been fought in Mosul. So the US backed coalition is fighting against Islamic State in Mosul. So since a month the battle is going on, but the government troops have not yet made any substantial territorial gains. Plus the number of civilians killed here has been by UN estimate 20%, as against 5% civilian casualties in other places where fight against IS is going on. So here there are high civilian casualties too. Also the point is that Mosul is Sunni dominated city, plus Iraq and Iraqi government, Iraqi forces are Shia. So Sunni Shia conflict again comes up here too. So it is also required, UN also highlights that it is required that Iraqi troops, which are largely Shia, should deal with these millions of people who live in Mosul Sunni with humanity, so that even the fight against IS could be won. So this is also an important point, how IS has been able to gain grounds in these regions. So these are Sunni majority regions in a Shia country, Shia government. So in a previous anti-IS battles, Iraqi troops were accused of targeting Sunni civilians. So if Baghdad doesn't win the Sunnis over who are living in this war-ravaged north and northwestern Iraq, then the grip of terror will continue to haunt Iraq. So that is highlighted by this editorial. So this is about Mosul also. So Mosul lies here, you can see. This is under Islamic State, this is under government, and this is where the Kurds are powerful. Then the next is what we look at is the question bank. So for 29th November we have picked up one question. The lead article in today's newspaper is on Pakistan Army Chief's selection. So this, what it's talking about is the new army chief, how would it be appointed, and an opportunity for Pakistani government to come out of the grips of the army. But then no question as such could be framed. UPSC is not going to ask you a question on how Pakistan government should function. So I've skipped this lead article. The other article on the perspective page is again on majoritarian governments and especially on Donald Trump and how after winning the policies should be inclusive, taking the whole electorate into consideration and not only the section which voted for you. So the policies should be all inclusive. So that has been highlighted. Plus another article in the perspective page is on fake news and how fake news has also helped Donald Trump win elections, because these fake news are circulated to such an extent, especially by Facebook and also Google, who are news aggregators and not news generators. So these news then are published so often and shared so often that people are not able to distinguish between what is a fake news and what is true. So this, the post-truth which we hear of to right now. So these aspects are highlighted in this article. What needs to be done? There are no answers. Facebook is also saying that it will talk to news print media and other news generators about what steps need to be taken to safeguard from fake news. So we'll have to wait and watch what happens on this. But present article has no content with the basis of which you can write an answer. So of course, this is an issue. Fake news is an issue. Hopefully, we'll get better articles later in with which we can write an answer about what steps need to be taken to counter this. So we'll have to wait for that. But you can give in suggestions. Suggestions are always welcome. Even the newspapers, print media has to take up the responsibility. Facebook and Google, of course, have to take up the responsibility. So this one point is for sure there, that these news aggregators also have to take up the responsibility to filter out fake news. And they are not doing enough. So that is there. Plus, the next article on the basis of which I framed a question is on environment. So this is, the infrastructure projects often run through wild habitats, resulting in irreversible damage to ecology and environment. How can ecological conservation and economic development be balanced? So this is regarding infrastructure projects which are planned, like for example, proposal for a railway line to be laid within Dandeli Wildlife Sanctuary in Karnataka. Also, there are plans to widen NH44, which is again lying within Dandeli Wildlife Sanctuary. Then there are plans to cut down 30,000 trees to connect, have a 65 kilometer connecting road between two regions in Karnataka. So again, these are going to affect the wildlife habitat, flora and fauna in these regions. So even a 60 kilometer stretch, another example given, which has is a road which will be reopened for regular traffic in Kaval Tiger Reserve in Telangana. So all these highlight the intrusive infrastructural projects. They are called linear intrusion projects by this article. So these are having significant ecological impact. So there is a need to study them too, that what will be their impact on wildlife habitat. It will result in diversity reduction. Plant diversity would also reduce. The wildlife habitat would get fragmented. Some may also be lost. It will result in hundreds of animals being killed every day too because of various kinds of accidents which we hear of, train accidents, road accidents, also by electrocution. So all these are also important points which need to be highlighted when such infrastructure projects are planned. So the way out, balancing as it says, of ecological conservation and economic development can be through recognizing and accepting the huge impact of linear infrastructure project on wildlife and wildlife habitat, means on flora and fauna. So this requires that all entities, civil engineers, planners and conservationists, ecologists should work together with policymakers, bureaucrats and politicians. So a common framework should be developed which can help in balancing these two aspects. So there should be avoidance of placing such linear infrastructure projects in forests and wildlife areas, and it should minimize any such effect which it would have only when it is impossible to go ahead and place, and only option is to place such infrastructure projects passing through forests. In such cases too, minimum interference is ensured, should be highlighted. So that is how it can make sure that both aspects, because this says infrastructure projects are short term in the sense short term gains for a few moment of time. An infrastructure project needs further upgradation too, so that it may last for say a century also, but in natural habitat and ecosystems being destroyed are irreversible losses. They cannot be replenished. So that should also be taken into consideration when such infrastructure projects are given a thumbs up. So this is what is required, that India's long-term ecological sustainability is being ruthlessly sacrificed for short-term economic gains. So with this, it highlights that natural infrastructure is also important and has to be conserved and preserved. So this is it for today. Thank you so much.